and welcome to the Potter's House Community Church. We exist to serve by restoring the whole person. We see man restoring his creator, body, spirit, and soul through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this year, it's like a build up to what the Lord has entrusted us with last year. Our theme for last year was End Beyond. And our theme for this year, ladies and gentlemen, let's have a look.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
lives within me. So I will walk in your peace. Your spirit lives within me. My victory.
If you believe it, so
your spirit lives within me.
Holds me.
you, Lord, that you are our shepherd, you are our God, you are our everything, you are our shepherd, you are our peace, you are our joy, you are our fortress. We run to you from all calamities. We run to you from all attacks of the enemy. We run to you when we are desperate. We run to you, Lord, when the enemy attacks. For you promise like that, like a flood, you will raise a standard against him. We lift your name on high, King of Kings. Yes, Lord, and we hold on to you because we realize that we couldn't have made it this far had it not been for you, Jesus. We love you and we honor you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Without you,
oh, I
I'm wiser, I am better, so much better. When I look back over where you brought me from, I can see how you were there for me. I
forsake us, your Lord, and you've never left us nor forsook us. You said the flood will not destroy, the waters will not drown you, and you said the fire will not burn you. And indeed, Lord, you've kept your promises. We've seen you do it through Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We've seen you carry our forefathers in the past through hard times, through hardships, through troubles. And we know that, Lord, faithful as you've been, you will continue to be faithful with us as we're facing this time of an incredible, horrific pandemic. Lord, we put our trust unto you. And we say, Lord, we will make it through because you are by our side. You are our strength. You are our peace. You are our everything, Lord. We hold on to you because you are our shepherd. You are our all in all, Father. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, you made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it felt as if it was all over, when we felt like there was no hope, Lord, you made a way. I'm saying this, Lord, prophetically, so believing that in the midst of chaos, in the midst of despair that we find ourselves in as a country, in the midst of hunger, in the midst of the pandemic, in the midst of all these troubles that we find ourselves in, you are able to make a way. We know, we've seen you do it before. This is not going to be a new thing for you to make a way. You've made a way before. I remember the children of Israel, they cried out, they said, when we saw the deliverance of our people, when we saw our deliverance, we were like those that were dreaming. We could not believe it. Yes, indeed, Lord, they could not believe it, but you did it for them. You made a way for them. After 40 years or so of them, 400 years of them being stranded and being in captivity, you made a way, Lord. You've done it before. You've done it for our country in the years past when we thought that apartheid would not be destroyed, and yet you made a way. When we were scared and we thought that there was going to be a terrible bloodbath, you made a way. And the rest of the world looked as they were praying for us and standing in agreement before your throne room of grace. You made a way. Lord, we can continue to count on our blessings that we've seen you make, do for us as a country. And we stand right here, Lord, not just for ourselves as a country, as South Africa, but we're also praying for the rest of the world. We pray for our continent, Africa. We pray for our neighbors, Zimbabwe, Lesotho, Zambia, Botswana. We pray for Swaziland, Lord. We pray for all of these countries, and especially with the economic setup that they find themselves in. We pray, Father, and we plead that you make a way for us, Lord. We pray that there should not be any more deaths. We pray, Father God, that your hand should come and hover upon us. Make a way, Lord. When our backs are as they are against the wall and it seems as if it's over, we know you are able to make a way. We're calling on you, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, to make a way. We're trusting, Lord. We're holding on. We're holding our hands in agreement and say, make a way, Lord. You make a way. We trust you to make a way. There is nothing impossible with you, Lord. There is nothing difficult with you. We call on you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for making a way. We thank you, Jesus. For this is the confidence that we have, that as we ask anything according to your will, we know that you hear us, Father. And as we know that you hear us, we know that we have received that which we ask of you. And we honor you, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. We give you all the glory, the highest praise. You are our God. We know that you will never disappoint us. We know, for you promised, and your promises are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. Amen. Brethren, we're going to break bread now. A dear friend of mine from Gauteng will be visiting us today in our living rooms, in our spaces right now, to break bread with us. Thank God for technology. He will be ministering to us. We're going to join him right now, all the way from Midrand. Dr. Sandy Malapile, I've known him for years. I can say a lot about him, but he's an anointed man of God, a God-fearing man of God, a man that was born for such a time as this, a man that hears the heart of God. And believe you me, what he's going to be sharing with you, it's from the heart of God. And I know that it's fresh bread from the throne room of grace. Receive it, enjoy it, let it be to the nourishment of your lives, your hope, your faith, the essence of who you are. Spirit of the Lord, I pray that you prepare our ears and our hearts to receive from you, as your servant will be ministering to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay. I said greetings in the name of Jesus. We're going to study this morning the word. We just want to welcome you. We thank you for being able to join us. If you can, open with us the Mark chapter 4, open with us Mark chapter 4. As we are opening, we are talking about we are starting a topic called removing the mask of fear. Removing the mask of fear. Mark chapter 4, reading from verse 35 to verse 41, which is the end of that chapter. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm going to read in a few minutes. That day, when evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion, on a pillow. The disciples woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up. He rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, Jesus said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" Verse 41, they were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Amen.
We are talking about removing the mask of fear. Somebody say, removing the mask of fear. I want to quickly just get to the word. The enemy, which is the devil, camouflage fear in the following four masks. The devil hides his fear in a number of masks. This mask we are going to talk about this morning are just four. Number one, the devil hides fear in the mask of worry. The first mask is the mask of worry. So the enemy makes people to worry. And when we read Luke chapter 12, verse 22, Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I say to you, don't worry about your life." Don't worry about your life. "What you shall eat, nor about your body, what you shall wear." Life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. "Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which have neither storehouse nor barn, and God feeds them. How much more value are you than the birds? And which of you by worrying can add a cubit to his stature? If you then are not able to do the least, why are you anxious for the rest? Consider the lilies, the flowers, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I say unto you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these flowers. If then God so clothed the grass, which today is the field and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith?" Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the enemy camouflage fear in the mask of worry. What is worry? Worry is negative expectation of the future. You are worried that things will not go well in the future. That is worry. And we can read, we don't have time, we can read Matthew chapter 6, 25 to 34, which is the same as just what we read. Number two, the enemy camouflage fear in the mask of anger. The enemy camouflage worry in the fear in the mask of the mask of fear in the mask of anger. So what fear? People are angry. They are angry that the things will not turn out in the positive way in which they want. They are angry that things that don't go in their own way. And the result of that is to have fear and lack of trust in God. Now let's read Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26. If you have it, say amen. Amen. Ephesians 4, verse 26. This is how it reads. Be angry. You are allowed to be angry. But in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, nor give place to the devil. How do you give place to the devil? You give place to the devil by being angry and sinning. And also by being angry and allow the anger to keep you the whole day. And you sleep with your anger. And when you do that, you give place to the devil, and the enemy is able to attack you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now we see that Jesus was angry in Mark chapter 3. We are not going to read that. Because of the hardness of the hearts of the Pharisees. But he did not sin. Out of his anger, because the Pharisees did not believe in him, he healed the woman. Sometimes anger can lead to positive change. But the enemy is using fear, camouflaging anger inside. Number three, the third mask of fear that the enemy is hiding is withholding or withdrawing. What is to withdraw? To withdraw is to refuse to give. For example, when the investor does not want to, is afraid to invest. When the leader is in fear, he hides information. When the shopper is in fear, he does not spend his money. So withholding is a trap. So the enemy is using the mask of withdrawing. That by withdrawing, you are not able to benefit. Now, if you read Proverbs chapter 11, verse 24 to 26. Proverbs 11, 24 to 26. This is how it reads. There is one who scatters, yet increases more. And there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will be watered himself. The people will curse him who withholds grain, but blessing will be on the head of him who sells it. So number three, the mask that the enemy is using is the mask of withholding. So number four, the enemy is using the mask of procrastination. Procrastination. I will do it later. I will do it tomorrow. Postponement. Delay. Hallelujah. So we need to be very careful that we learn to act immediately. Somebody say, praise the Lord. How does fear come? Second part of our sermon. How does fear come? Fear comes on the street of senses, exposure, and environment. Fear walks in the street of the people who depend on their senses, they are exposed to some things, and they are in a certain environment. That's how fear comes. Fear comes, number one, senses. In our lives, we've got what you call the eye gate. What you see comes into you. For example, we are seeing the news here about corona. Is the eye gate. The eye gate of medical reports. The news I've spoken about the financial report, the weather reports. All those things can bring fear because of seeing, because we are seeing. Is the sense of sight. Number two is the exposure. Fear comes through exposure. One who's exposed to scary movies, fear information on social media, you can see many things that are scary. And the other thing that we have a challenge in today is that we have got many social media experts. A person just wakes up and sends, he says an expert, he starts to make comments, and then he's scaring other people. So that is the second way in fear, in which fear comes. Number one, fear comes through the senses. Number two, it comes through exposure. What are you exposed to? You watch a scary movie, you won't sleep at night. Number three, it comes to environment. When you are in an environment that is physically and socially not safe, you live in fearful areas. There are some people who walk in a certain place at night. Just by knowing that in this area there's crime and what and all those issues, you start to be attacked by fear. Now fear comes in that format. Another question, part three of our sermon: how can I overcome fear? How can I master fear in my life? Please do the following steps. To master fear, you must do the following step. Step number one, control fear access points. In other words, control the gates in which we spoke about earlier. Control your eye gate, your ear gate, because fear comes through the senses, the eye gate and the ear gate. So if you don't control your ear gate, you just, as I gave an example earlier, you watch a scary movie, you listen to scary stories at night, you are alone, fear is going to come. So you must also guard. Number two, you must connect to people who inspire you. Number one, you must control your access point, fear's access points, which is the ear gate and the eye gate. Number two, you must connect to people who inspire your faith. Connect to somebody who inspires your faith. For example, Peter connected to Jesus. It is Jesus who said to Peter, come. And what did Peter do? Peter came. So Peter was able to walk on the water because he connected to Jesus' faith. He associated with faith. When you associate with people who inspire you, when you associate to people who have faith, those people are able to inspire you. Number three, focus on God's word. Read God's word. Meditate God's word. I'm learning something that I've not learned in many years as a Christian, that you must speak the scripture aloud. My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Nothing shall separate me from the love of Christ, the love of God which is in Christ. Neither life nor death, nor angels, nor things in the past, nor things present, nor things in the past shall be able to separate me from the love of God. So we need to speak the word. We're not just, because faith comes by hearing. Faith comes by hearing. When you speak your own, when you hear your own speaking, then you start to have. Hallelujah. Amen. So that is the end of our service. I just want to encourage you that when we look at the scripture that we have read, going back to the scripture, Mark chapter 4, verse 35 to 41, we learn something here, that Peter was suffering. There's something in medical world is called strabismus, strabismus. Strabismus is what we call eye disorder, when one eye is looking that side, another eye is looking that side. Some people are suffering from that in the natural. So Peter was suffering from this because he looked at what Jesus said, but he also looks at the waves, he looks at the winds, he looked at the water. And what did the water, the wind, do to him? He started to be afraid. So God help us that we only look at God's word, because God's word, speaking God's word, believing God's word, trusting God's word, we will be able to overcome all the fears, we will overcome all the anxieties, we will overcome all the stresses of life. Why? Because we put our trust in God. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So we're coming to the end of our service. I'm going to ask you to close our eyes, and we're going to pray in the name of Jesus. Let's sing. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am. Let's pray. Let's pray. Our Father and our God. Everybody, let's pray in the name of Jesus. We just want to thank you for this day. We just want to thank you this week. We just want to thank you for this month. We just want to thank you for this year. We just want to thank you for this minute and this second. My Father, in the name of Jesus, we just want to thank you that you are our shepherd. We shall not be afraid. We shall not be scared. We shall not be intimidated. My Father and my God, we are praying for the Madala families. We are praying for the Madala families, those who are connected with them and those who are in KZN. We are praying, Lord, for Nunu family. In the mighty name of Jesus, we are praying, Lord, for Auntie Busi's family, even the mother in Mpumalanga. In the name of Jesus, we are praying, Lord, for Munanyana's family right now. We pray, Lord, for Daniel's family in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray for Manyati. We pray, Lord, for Brother Freedom's family in the name of Jesus. We pray for Murubani's family. We pray for everybody right now in the mighty name of Jesus, that we shall be saved and we shall be delivered from fear. We shall not be afraid, for the Lord is our shepherd. The Bible says, I call upon the Lord, and he delivered me from all my fears. We are delivered from all our fears. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. We say you are worthy to be praised. In Jesus' name, we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. Thank you for the peace of God. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen. And amen. Please send us some comments. If the Lord has touched you, say some comments there on the comments button downstairs. God bless you, and we will continue to pray for you. Amen. Same time next week. Let's invite other people. God bless you. Amen.
Thank you very much, Dr. Malapile, for breaking bread with us. I knew very well that you would not disappoint. And not that it's you that's not disappointing, but it is God that would not disappoint us. We know very well that as a humble servant as you are, you shared his heart. You gave us his heart, and we receive the word as it is. And we know that it is able to save us to the uttermost. And we thank you that you were able to give us this very incorruptible word that is able to turn our lives around and transform us to be in the very image and likeness of God, of Christ our Savior. Thank you very much. May the good Lord continue to bless you, continue to use you, continue to reveal his mysteries unto you. And may God bless your family that is so supportive, standing by you, praying for you. Thank you very much, Dr. Malapile. God bless you. Family, have a blessed Sunday. Have a blessed week. We meet again, this very same place, this very same time, this very same space. And may the good Lord bless you. Amen.